Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Atlantic Island by Fredric Shernoff, narrated by Eric Michael Summerer. Book 1. The Event. Chapter 1. 1. Theo had never expected life to be so unsatisfying. It wasn't as if he felt entitled to anything in particular. No brass ring being held extra low for him to grab, or crown to be placed on his head. It was simply that he always assumed he would know his purpose when the time was right. As a cool Philadelphia spring gave way to the heat of summer, the students of the junior class at Mifflin High School filled the halls with talk of SAT scores, campus visits, and summer plans to pad the ever-important college application. Theo walked among these conversations not quite eavesdropping, but perhaps observing, with a goal of understanding. It wasn't that Theo's grades weren't up to snuff. Although he had floundered in middle school, he had redeemed himself over the past few years and now held a strong B average. He knew that he would be applying to colleges after what would most certainly be an embarrassing series of school tours with Mom and Dad along for the ride. The problem was that Theo didn't care about anything in particular. He had briefly considered the notion that he may be what the school counselor called clinically depressed. Theo didn't agree. He had seen depression personified among the outcasts in school trying to express themselves. That wasn't him. Black wasn't his color. No, depression wasn't the diagnosis. If he had been asked to label himself, Theo would have gone with disappointed. He had spent his 17 years believing that he was following a predetermined course. True, he didn't know where that road was leading him, but he was resigned to follow. Now, when it seemed everyone else was taking charge of his or her destiny, Theo had turned to his trusty muse and found that his travel guide had abandoned him. Theo's friends shared his habit of dabbling in school activities without being too involved in any one thing. They also shared his confusion and uncertainty about the future. What they seemed to lack, Theo reckoned, was his frustration. They appeared content to say, "Screw it, life makes no sense and we'll figure it out when and if we can." Theo's difficulty was that he expected to know the answers. He thought the goals would be self-evident and he would just have to strive for them. No such luck. When summer break finally arrived, Theo burst from the confines of Mifflin and hopped in the car to meet his friends for pizza. He saw several of the other students' vehicles heading the same direction out of the school parking lot. Arriving at the pizza parlor, Theo saw Emily Nelson and her friends standing outside and leaning on the stone facade at the base of the large windows. Theo felt his stomach do somersaults. He had had a deep, ridiculous love for Emily for the majority of his high school career thus far. She knew it, and had been reasonably kind about the whole thing, but there wasn't any chance that Theo and Emily would ever be a couple. For one thing, Emily was the most popular girl in the school, and had been since the start of sophomore year, when the senior boys started to take an interest in her. That meant that even if she had shown interest in Theo, her friends would never have approved of the pairing. Then there was the matter of Theo's tongue, which seemed to tie up at the worst possible moments and had proven incapable of having anything resembling conversation with Emily Nelson. Seeing her standing outside Mifflin Pizza, Theo had a vision of himself boldly approaching Emily and greeting her. He knew, as he stepped out of his car and pressed the handle to lock the doors, that he was going to avoid her and her friends completely instead. If Emily knew he was there, she showed no sign. She just kept talking to her friends as Theo slinked past toward the door. "Hey, douchebag." "No." Theo whirled around. In his mad desire to avoid the cool crowd, he had missed the gang of thugs crowding the other side of the entrance to the restaurant. "What's up, Bertier?" Theo said, trying to play cool and comfortable. Carl Bertier laughed and put his hand on his shaved head. "What's up? Bro, you talk like we're friends. I ain't your friend, Essex, but..." He stepped next to Theo and put his burly arm around Theo's shoulders. Bertier's friends gawked and laughed like a pack of hyenas. "Me and my boys here don't got any cash for pizza. How about you hook us up?" Theo cringed. While the popular kids could be cruel at times, Bertier and his kind were downright dangerous. Carl himself had been in and out of juvie 3 times in the past 2 years. Theo often wondered why the system continued to allow people like that back into school. "I only have enough money for myself," he said, hating the tremble in his voice. "That works," said Bertier, tightening his grip on Theo's shoulder. He leaned toward Theo's ear and whispered conspiratorially, "You buy me a slice. Fuck those other guys, am I right?" Theo nodded miserably. He reached into his pocket for the $5 bill his parents had provided him for a post-finals lunch. "Is there a problem here?" Theo's friend Bill, a baseball player who dabbled in the world of the cool crowd but spent most of his time out of it, had arrived and was walking purposefully over to Theo and Bertier. Theo noticed the crowd around Emily Nelson were watching the drama unfold.
"Billy the Kid, this don't concern you," Bertier said.
He took his arm off Theo's shoulders, but if he was at all worried about Bill's arrival, he didn't show it. To the contrary, the broad, stupid smile on his face seemed to say that he was just as pleased as Punch with this new development.
"If it concerns my friend, it concerns me," Bill said. "If you have any sense in that big fat melon you call a head, you'll take your buddies and go find some other part of town to stink up."
Bertier got up in Bill's face. His friends crowded in behind him. Theo ducked back behind his friend, grateful to be out of Bertier's reach.
"You want to watch yourself," Bertier said. "My boys don't like you getting all tough with me."
The two teens stared at each other, faces inches apart. Theo was sure they were going to come to blows, and he didn't know what he would be able to do to help Bill. Then, a few of the guys who knew Bill from the baseball team walked past Theo and right up to ground zero of the conflict. Bertier backed away.
"This place sucks ass anyway. Let's go, boys."
As Mifflin's resident troublemakers filed into their car, Bertier blew a kiss at Bill and Theo.
"Some other time, losers."
Theo looked around. The cool kids had already forgotten about the whole incident and were back talking about whatever it was people like that talked about. To Theo, that was a whole other world.
"Thanks for the help," he said to Bill. "Those guys are such assholes."
"Those guys are what's wrong with this town."
"Don't worry, Theo. My pop says that dumb shits like that end up in jail or working at Mickey D's."
Theo laughed.
"Yeah, man, I know. I just wish I could stand up to them. Or talk to Emily. I don't know what's wrong with me."
They walked into the pizza shop.
"Nothing wrong with you," Bill said. "It's what's wrong with the rest of them. You're nervous because you know that if you put yourself out there, you'll get your head bit off or your ass handed to you. You're just being smart."
They ordered their pizzas.
"Still,"
Theo said, "it just sucked with Emily there and all."
"Enough about Emily," Bill said. "Dude, she doesn't know you exist. Forget about her. There are like a million awesome girls out there. Chill for a second and let yourself explore the options."
They sat down at a table for 4 with 2 slices of cheese steak pizza each. By that time, the shop was bustling with liberated high schoolers. Soon, Mark and Ryan would join them. Mark always drove Ryan, and Mark was always late.
"Changing the subject a little," said Bill.
"So when are we going to head to the shore this summer?"
Bill asked.
"Why the shore?"
"Well, for one, it's ridiculously hot out here. For another, the girls are ridiculously hot down there. It's a no-brainer."
Theo thought about it.
"Well, we could stay at the motel near where my grandparents have their condo."
"Why can't we just stay at the condo?"
Bill asked.
"It's cheaper."
"Dude," said Theo, "it's my grandparents' place. I don't want their friends checking up on us and reporting back. They might be using the place anyway."
"Fair enough. The motel it is, then."
The door jingled as it was opened. Mark and Ryan entered and made their way to the table.
"What's up, boys?"
Mark said.
"We're going to the shore," Bill said. "We're going to stay in a motel, and there will be girls, and Ryan will remember what it's like to be touched by a woman."
"Hey," Ryan laughed. "I had a girlfriend more recently than the rest of you losers."
Theo grinned.
"He does have a point, Bill. Why don't you guys sit down? We were just laying out the details. Plus, you can hear about how Bill punked out Bertier."
No shit!
Mark exclaimed. Good for you, man. I wish you'd punched his ass out, though.
Me too, Bill said. A guy can dream.
The four boys spent the next hour consuming too much pizza and vast amounts of soda while plotting their conquest of the New Jersey shore. They agreed to stay in Ventnor, just south of Atlantic City, but on the same island. One night would absolutely have to include a trip to Ocean City on the next island down because, as Mark put it,
that's where the action is.
Ryan, who was never without his smartphone, tapped away as he researched what it would cost for this little adventure. He had not actually had a girlfriend recently or at all. His friends didn't know this because Ms. Linda Fine attended Jenkintown High. Although Linda, like everyone else, had a Facebook page, the other guys couldn't see her profile because the whirlwind romance had imploded quickly and friends don't friend their boy's ex. In reality, Ryan and Linda had met at a programming competition and he had been too nervous to ask her out, though not too nervous to send that one-click request for friendship.
I think the motel's going to work really well, said Ryan.
That's your conclusion? Asked Mark.
Damn, Rye, for a genius, you took a long time to tell us what we already know.
I'll tell you what else, this is gonna be the trip of a lifetime, guys.
2. That weekend, the guys all piled into Mark's Honda Accord and hit the road. As they approached the rest stop on the Atlantic City Expressway, Bill asked if he could visit the men's room. All four were in agreement that this was a great idea, so Mark pulled into the rest stop parking lot. The facility, recently remodeled, was the only place to take a break along the expressway without bailing at one of the exits. Families and groups of teens and young adults streamed in and out of the doors, filled the tables in the rest stop's main cafeteria, and waited in long lines for the artery-clogging goodness that one finds along the country's highways and byways. Theo went to the bathroom with the other guys and spent a little extra time at the sink examining his reflection in the mirror. This was the last chance to make some appearance adjustments before arriving at the shore. He listened to the conversations around him. A trucker at a urinal argued with his buddy about whether the president should do more to protect the dang homeland instead of worrying about all them Arabs in Iraq and them places. He pronounced Arabs like Arabs.
I'm telling you, Lenny, one of them brown-skinned sons of bitches is going to blow this whole country straight to hell, and that damned president will be sitting twiddling his thumbs.
Lenny grumbled his agreement, and racist trucker adjusted his zipper and made his way to the door. He did this, Theo noticed, without bothering to stop by the sink. Lenny, who had to be 6'6" and 300 pounds, also showed his disdain for personal hygiene on his way out of the men's room. Theo had a passing thought about racist trucker and Lenny swapping germs with a big high five, maybe after Lenny made a great point about those brown-skinned sons of bitches running wild in the homeland. He chuckled as he turned back to the mirror. Theo dried his hands after putting the finishing touches on his short hair. The music playing from the restroom speakers ended, and a news report came on. Scientists warn that a comet the size of Manhattan has a 1 in 10,000 chance of hitting the Earth.
Good Lord, Theo thought. Do they ever come up with anything positive to report?
Let's go, buddy. The chicks are awaiting.
Mark came up behind Theo and shocked him out of his thoughts.
All right, Jesus, I'm ready. You don't have to scare the crap out of me.
I don't know, man.
I think a bathroom is the perfect place to scare the crap out of you.
Theo shook his head and laughed.
Wow, Mark. Just terrible. All right, let's get moving. Want to grab some coffee before we go?
3. Back on the road, Theo stared out the window, thinking about the trucker and the announcement on the radio news. Mark fiddled with his iPhone, and soon the sounds of Maroon 5 blasted from the Accord speakers. The teens cracked jokes and listened to the music as the miles rolled by.
Hey, that guy in the car over there is staring at me, Ryan exclaimed.
Are you sure that's not because you're staring at him? Bill asked.
Oh, I guess you're right.
Just then the car passed exit 6, and Theo thought, the exits count down because we are heading to the edge of the world. He shuddered. What the hell kind of thought was that? Just then, a blue Mazda 3 sped by, giving just the flash of what appeared to be young female occupants.
Whoa, Bill said. Speed up and let's see what we've got here. Mark stepped hard on the accelerator, and the Accord moved up until it was neck and neck with the Mazda. Sure enough, the driver and two passengers were all teenage girls. Bill waved, and the girl in the rear driver's side seat waved back with a smile. She had long brown hair, and judging from the waving arm, was on the skinny side. The driver was blonde and gorgeous in profile. She kept her eyes firmly on the road in a way that said, "Yes, I know there are boys to my left, so I'm going to ignore them. So there." The front passenger was hidden from view.
"My friends," said Mark, "these girls are headed to the same place as us."
"Mark," said Ryan,
"we still have a couple more exits, and even then we're heading to an island of three different towns and a city. What makes you so sure we're going to run into them?"
Mark sat back and smirked.
"When you know, you know. Those ladies are ours."
"Works for me," said Bill. Theo wasn't sure about Mark's prophecy, but thought it would be interesting to see how far they traveled the same route as the girls. He was already fantasizing about meeting the young ladies and wondering if he had the nerve to actually make those fantasies reality. He doubted it, but then again, he doubted they would ever see those girls again. The green sign for Exit 2, Atlantic City via Black Horse Pike, approached, and Mark turned on his signal to shift lanes. Theo was not surprised to see the Mazda, now a few car lengths ahead of them, do the same. After rounding the exit ramp, the car came out on Route 322. From there, it was just a mile or so to West End Avenue. West End was a brief trip past the wetlands and bay of Ventnor Heights. As a child, Theo had passed these sights many times. His mother used to encourage the kids to sing "Down by the Bay" each time they drove by. Theo and his two older sisters had always obliged. Ventnor Heights was home to a small shopping center that stood three-quarters abandoned. The economy had taken its toll, but things had rarely ever been good there. Businesses couldn't survive when most of the action only happened 3 months out of the year. Atlantic City and its suburbs were supposed to have been rejuvenated years ago by the casino industry, but instead the big corporations got richer and the city became more depressed. The Accord crossed the small bridge to the Ventnor mainland and soon pulled up next to the Sea Suns Motel. Theo thought the play on words was ridiculous. The motel took its blue and white color scheme to an extreme, though some of the blue was wearing away and in need of a fresh paint job. The town's battle with the infamous Hurricane Sandy probably hadn't helped maintain the buildings. The guys took their bags from the car and entered the small lobby. The manager, an older Hispanic man with graying hair and a small scar on his cheek, fixed his gaze on them and frowned. He continued to stare as they approached, as if to say, "Oh yes, I've seen your kind before. I know what kind of mischief teenage boys are all about." Bill stepped forward.
"Top of the morning, good sir. My colleagues and I request your finest room."
The manager scowled but said nothing, shifting his glance to the computer monitor on the desk. He found a room and took Bill's credit card. The others would split the charge at the end of the trip. And so, Theo thought, the ritual of the motel check-in is complete. He wondered how many strangers the manager had seen pass through the lobby doors. Families seeking easy access to the beach, co-ed groups of teens seeking easy access to each other. This made him think of the girls in the Mazda. They should have been there by now if they were actually staying at the Sea Suns. Clearly, Mark's intuition was off, not that that came as a surprise. Their room was on the second floor on the far side of the building. It faced the street, but the ocean wasn't far away. The second floor walkway wrapped around the whole building. Theo had once been visiting his grandparents and had seen kids jumping off the top of the motel into the pool. Someone called the police and the nonsense was resolved. Theo always enjoyed seeing obnoxious people get their comeuppance. Bill slipped the key card into the scanner, saw the light turn green, and opened the door. They entered a small living room with a sofa bed along one wall. A small television sat on a shelf, and a comfy red chair, just a shade darker than the red of the sofa, nestled in the opposite corner. A narrow hallway led to a back bedroom with two twin beds. The group quarreled briefly over sleeping arrangements before agreeing on a rotation that forced each boy to have to share the sofa bed at least once.
Ryan grabbed the remote from on top of the television and pressed the power button while he walked backwards toward the chair. The television, a thick, old-fashioned model, came on and he flipped through the channels. Ryan paused on CNN, which at that moment featured Anderson Cooper interviewing a seismologist about some suspicious tremors somewhere in Iowa.
"So you're saying the American people don't have any reason to be concerned?" Cooper asked.
The scientist, wearing thick spectacles beneath his greasy hair, stared into the camera.
"I'm saying that we have no evidence to suggest that anything significant is happening. What we have seen are a few minor incidences that barely register on the scale."
Bill reached over and grabbed the remote from Ryan. He turned the television off.
"Enough of that crap. Let's get changed and hit the beach while the sun is still good."
4. The four teenagers, now dressed in swim trunks and flip-flops, walked down to ground level and crossed over the boardwalk onto the sand. The beach was crowded, and Theo had to carefully avoid a minefield of sandcastles and kid toys as he ran to the ocean's edge. Theo sat down on the wet, hard-packed sand and allowed the waves to lap around him. He looked out into the great expanse in front of him. Off to the side, the Pier Mall was visible even here, miles away from Atlantic City. Though Theo enjoyed the opulence of the mall and its fancy restaurants, he had preferred it in its previous life, when the top draws were a large arcade and an international food court. Other than the pier, he saw nothing but water. Theo loved that about the ocean. Sure, he knew that Europe or Africa or whatever was somewhere on the other end of that vastness, but for all intents and purposes, this was the edge of all things. There was a strange peace in that thought.
"You know, you might want to look around you and check out the girls instead of the fish," Bill spoke from behind Theo.
He wore a sleeveless shirt, though he was the only one of the four with a defined six-pack.
"Hey, man," Theo said. "If you want to go and be a creeper, that's fine, but I'm good right where I am."
"All right, bro. You and Rye can do your thing. More for Mark and me."
They stayed on the beach for 3 hours. Bill and Mark spoke to every girl they could find, and Theo eventually joined them in tossing a frisbee. Exhausted, they made their way back to the motel to shower and change for the night. At 6 p.m., they piled back into Mark's car for the half-hour drive south to Ocean City. They circled the streets 3 times before finding a parking spot. Walking up the wooden ramp to the boardwalk, Theo was swept up in the atmosphere. The boards were packed with people, mainly teens of both genders. Theo felt his eyes drawn from one girl to the next. The bright lights of the signs above the shops mixed with varying beats emanating from speakers in the storefronts and created a hypnotic effect. They decided to eat at a pizza parlor, but one that was very different from the usual hangout at home. With its doors wide open, the oceanfront shop filled with the scents and sounds of the boardwalk. The guys ordered a giant pepperoni to share, declining the ultimate pizza challenge, which would have required one of them to consume the entire thing to get a photo up by the register.
"So," Mark started, "can we talk about the plan for the evening?"
Bill had his heart set on going to the Surf Mall, a collection of shops selling t-shirts, collectibles, and other unusual items. Ryan and Mark insisted on hitting up at least one arcade. Theo didn't really care where they went. He was enjoying himself and drinking in the experience. As Theo reached for a second slice, Ryan changed the subject.
"Have you guys figured out where you want to go to school?"
Bill faked a yawn.
"Really? You want to talk about this now?"
"Well," Ryan said, "I just think it's important that we focus on the future. We aren't going to be young forever."
"And I think," Bill said, "that you're killing me. Can't we focus on the present?"
"I'm just saying," said Ryan, "that the decisions we make now are going to affect the rest of our lives. Don't you have any plans, Mark?"
"Dude,"
said Mark, leaning back in the booth with his hands linked behind his head.
"Yeah, obviously. I'm going to go to college and be rich and famous and marry Selena Gomez. How's that sound?"
Ryan shook his head in dismay.
"Fine, screw you guys."
He ducked his head and went back to playing with his iPhone. Theo heard female laughter and looked up toward the entrance. Leaning against the counter was the blonde from the Mazda. Next to her were the brunette and a short Asian girl.
She was almost definitely the girl from the passenger seat.
"Guys, we've got company," Theo said.
The others looked up.
"Well, there you go," said Mark.
"This is fate."
He was already getting up and making his way over to the girls. Theo and the others followed. Mark introduced himself and his friends. The blonde girl, whose name was Jamie, clicked with Mark right away. She invited the guys to sit with them. Over the course of the next hour, Jamie and Mark laughed it up while Bill awkwardly flirted with Michelle, the Asian girl. Ryan seemed more interested in his phone, so Theo had no trouble focusing on Kylee, the brunette. Kylee was beautiful. She had her hair styled so that a chunk of it fell over one eye, and she continuously brushed it back with her hand as she talked. Theo was entranced. The girls were all from the town next to Mifflin and were about the same age as Theo and his friends. Jamie and Michelle had been friends since childhood, much like Bill and Ryan. Kylee had met them in middle school, and they had been close ever since. Theo found himself second-guessing almost everything he said. For someone who had spent a good amount of time drifting through life, he was suddenly quite focused. He wanted Kylee to like him, and shockingly, it seemed like she did. Of course, Theo thought, it's not like he hadn't misread those kinds of things before. He knew he had to make sure not to fall too hard for her too fast. That was a surefire way to turn her off. Still, as he looked at her, he knew that resisting Kylie's charms was going to be a challenge. The girls followed them to the arcade. Bill wowed Michelle by defeating the robotic arm wrestling game, while Theo and Kylee played skee-ball and air hockey. Ryan went from machine to machine, playing all the fighting games he could find. Mark and Jamie were nowhere to be found. Theo knew what that meant. Mark was not known for wasting time when he found a girl he liked. Theo was 1 point away from defeating Kylee in air hockey. He intentionally gave up the next 2 points. The first might have been debatable, but the second was an obvious dive as he stumbled against the table and swung wild, knocking the puck backward into his own goal.
"Are you letting me win?" Kylee asked with a smile.
"No." Theo couldn't help but smile back. It was amazing just how much he liked Kylee. She was gorgeous, sure, but he actually wanted to talk to her and not let himself drift away into his thoughts like he usually did. Even more shocking was that he could talk to her. His tongue seemed to be untangling itself the more they talked and laughed and played around. Kylee won the last point without any help. Theo walked around the table and high-fived her in a show of good sportsmanship. As the group all headed for the exit, Theo made a calculated gamble. He stuck out his hand, intentionally brushed it against Kylie's, and breathed a sigh of relief when she closed hers around his. He hoped she couldn't feel the sweat on his palm. On the walk back to the parking lot, Theo took time to marvel at how much fun he was having. Mark and Jamie had found them outside the arcade and were laughing it up loudly. Mark's arm was around Jamie's waist. By contrast, Bill walked next to Michelle, keeping a small distance between them. Bill was always so confident, if a bit awkward in his humor around almost everyone, yet he became nervous when he met a girl he liked. Theo couldn't help but smile. The girls were staying at Jamie's mom's place, not far from the Sea Suns Motel. Somewhere in the conversation, it was decided that they would all go back to the motel to hang out and see where the night went. Theo sat in the back of Jamie's Mazda with Kylee. Mark sat up front in the passenger seat. Ryan drove the Accord, with Bill and Michelle in the back seat. As they pulled out of the parking lot, Theo got a peek into the Accord. Bill was keeping the same small gap between him and Michelle. Kylee leaned over and whispered in his ear,
"Let's go for a walk when we get back."
Her breath tickled against his face, triggering a comfortable chill down the length of his body, and he felt himself becoming aroused. Theo looked at her as she brushed back that errant piece of hair. A walk sounded like a very good idea. When the cars were parked back at the motel, Theo and Kylee walked up on the boards, leaving the others to their own fun. Theo leaned his arms on the rail facing the ocean. The waves rolled pleasantly into shore in the dark.
"So," Theo said, "tell me something interesting about you."
Kylee shrugged.
"I don't know. I'm not really all that interesting." Theo turned to face her and took her hand. I can't imagine that. Well, okay, what are you planning to do this summer?
I have a job at the pharmacy a couple minutes from my house. I do gift wrapping and help people find greeting cards. See, you found a really interesting girl.
Theo smiled. I happen to think it's fascinating. I mean, I've always wanted to know how to tie one of those fancy curly bows.
Oh, it's very simple. You take scissors and...
Kylee raised an eyebrow.
Are you making fun of me?
Maybe a little?
Kylee grinned.
Okay, I'll remember that.
She walked over to the railing and pulled herself up on top of the metal bar.
So what do you do, funny man?
Theo looked toward the water.
I don't really do much right now. I mean, I hang with the guys, and I'm obviously thinking about college. I just haven't figured out exactly what I want to do.
He turned back to Kylee, disappointed in his answer.
He wanted everything he said to her to dazzle her.
Instead, he was dazzled as his eyes wandered over her body and focused on her toned legs in short jean shorts perched on the railing. He returned his gaze to her face. Making eye contact with Kylee was a difficulty he hadn't expected.
You'll get there, Kylee said. Just enjoy the summer.
Oh, I am, Theo said. It's off to a great start.
Theo stepped in front of Kylee, and she nudged him playfully with her foot. He wrapped his arms around her, wondering as he did who exactly he had become, and lifted her off the bar. With a grin, she shoved him backwards and ran for the stairs leading to the beach.
Come on, she called.
Theo, captivated, shed his sandals and followed Kylee onto the sand. He chased her down to the water, where she splashed in the edge of the tide. Kylie's silhouette in the moonlight beckoned to him. He reached out and pulled her around. This time she didn't push him away. Chapter 2. 1. Theo felt Kylie's lips against his. His arms were secure around her waist, and she wrapped hers around his neck. He was so lost in the experience, so overwhelmed by the force of nature that was this new girl and the confidence she had suddenly inspired in him, that he didn't hear the low rumbling on the horizon. A louder series of booms in the distance made Kylee pull away.
What was that?
I have no idea, Theo said, pulling her back toward him. Maybe a plane breaking the sound barrier or something? I think there's an airport near...
A massive, echoing bang interrupted him. The sky lit up with a series of flashes emanating both from miles behind the condos along the boardwalk and far out over the ocean. The rumbling continued and intensified. Theo's ears were ringing.
Okay, not a plane.
Kylee was holding her head.
What? I can't hear anything.
Theo scanned the horizon. The ocean was rolling in a way he had never seen before. The ground began to shake, vibrating like a massive motor. The sand shifted around Theo's feet as he stumbled toward Kylee, who was struggling to stay upright. The waters churned, and the waves rolled higher up the shore. Theo looked at the frothy surf reflecting the flashes of light in the sky. He took Kylee by the shoulder and pointed to the boardwalk. Run. They took off together, bobbing and staggering through the agitated sands. Small explosions and booms intermingled with pulses of light as they ran, each bright enough to mimic daylight, and through it all, he could hear that powerful roar, like an ancient machine suddenly and angrily awakened. They made it onto the boardwalk, which seemed to be holding strong against the shaking ground. Kylee leaned with her hands on her knees as she caught her breath. Theo was fascinated by how calm she was continuing to be in what was clearly a pretty messed up situation. He spun around to face her in the beach and gestured with arms wide.
What the hell is going on? He asked.
Kylee seemed to hear him well enough and began to answer when her eyes suddenly widened.
Look out!
She dove toward him and tackled him onto the boards. Composing himself on the shaking wooden structure and not ignorant of the light but firm weight on top of him, Theo looked to the left. Where he had been standing a second earlier, a deck chair was on its side, bent out of shape. The chair and the boards around it were covered with a crumbled concrete.
Looking up, Theo saw the missing piece of the third floor balcony. His mind fought to process what he was experiencing. Somehow, this earthquake, or whatever it was, had torqued and bent the motel enough to crack the concrete, surely in many places. The fact that the chair had tumbled through the opening and fallen forward seemed to imply that the land was tilting toward the ocean, yet the waves were coming closer with increasing ferocity. Theo looked into Kylie's eyes and mouthed, "Thank you." She nodded and rolled off him. The two of them sat side by side, afraid to stand as the shaking increased. Theo had been able to hear, or maybe it was feel, the bass of the rumbling, but now he could hear the entire strange noise more clearly, and other sounds as well. Sirens in the distance mingled with an electrical crackling.
"It's an earthquake, right?"
Kylee asked. She was surveying the scene with an impressive calm, but her eyes conveyed concern.
"I don't know. I've never been in one before. Have you?"
She shook her head.
"I went to California once and was scared shitless that one was going to hit. I guess I was right to be worried. I don't know. It seems like there's a lot more happening than just an earthquake." "Yeah, I noticed."
She pointed down the boardwalk to where the casinos and the Pier Mall flickered and sputtered in the distance.
"Whatever's happening is going to blow the power out soon."
As if she had magically decreed it, the lights went out one by one.
"Great. What we needed was some darkness. At least we've got the weird lights in the sky."
Theo stood up and offered Kylee his hand.
"We need to get off the boards before more crap falls on us. It's not safe. I think we have to find the others." "Yeah, you're right. Let's go."
Holding on to each other in a decidedly unromantic way, Theo and Kylee left the boardwalk and wandered down the side street to Atlantic Avenue. The main street was a disaster. Cars were abandoned in the middle of the road, though some had rammed into buildings and poles along the sides of the street. Fire hydrants spouted water into the air.
"Oh my God," Kylee said. "Look at the people."
There were people lying unconscious or worse in the street and on the sidewalks. Others, clearly alive, clung to the ground in fear. Still others wandered aimlessly, stumbling against the roll of the earth. The Hispanic man who had checked them into the motel wandered by, his eyes wide saucers of panic. He muttered, "No, no, no," over and over. He was bleeding from a cut on his shoulder, and his tank top was stained red. As he passed Theo and Kylee, he tripped and fell. The man scrambled to his feet and ran on, continuing his refrain,
"No, no, no."
Theo put his arm around Kylee. He still hadn't quite processed everything that had happened, certainly not the part where he was almost killed and had been saved by this amazing girl he had just met hours earlier. He was running on some deep, primitive survival instinct.
"So what do you think? Is this hell? Because I would have figured hell would be Camden, you know?"
The voice behind them was shaky, but still definitely Bill. Theo turned around and was relieved to see that his friend appeared to be unharmed.
"I don't know," said Theo. "It's something bad, that's for sure."
Just then, something occurred to him.
"I left my cell phone in the car. Maybe we can call somebody and find out what's going on." "Oh, shit," said Kylee. "I think mine fell out on the beach. It's underwater by now."
"Wouldn't help anyway," said Bill, holding up his phone. "There is absolutely no service. Not even one bar. Even the GPS signal is all wonky. Last time I tried, it said I'm in the middle of Springville, Utah."
"I'd take Utah right about now," said Theo. "Well, okay. So what other option do we have?"
asked Kylee. She gestured to the wreckage all over the street.
"We can't drive anywhere while the ground is shaking. Besides, there are too many people all over the place."
Bill hunched down as another small, concussive blast sounded.
"Ryan had this idea that he could get a signal from on the roof. He tried the motel and got nothing. He and Michelle are trying the building down the street where the girls are all staying. It's much higher."
Theo nodded. Leave it to Ryan to come up with some tech idea that might actually work.
"And Mark and Jamie?"
"Won't leave the motel. Mark thinks the world is coming to an end. It's that crap we saw on television earlier."
Theo shrugged.
"Look around you, man. Can you honestly say he's wrong?"
The rumbling intensified again.
"Get down, guys," Bill said.
I think another shockwave is coming.
The three of them hit the ground and covered their ears. Theo closed his eyes, but could still see the light of the biggest flash yet blooming in the darkness of his eyelids. A second later, the boom arrived. Even with his hands over his ears, he could feel his poor, battered eardrums take a hit. His head felt uncomfortably, almost painfully pressurized. Suddenly, the ground kicked up. Theo felt himself tossed into the air at least a foot and tried hard to roll when he landed. He bumped his shoulder a little, but was otherwise fine. Theo sat up and saw Bill and Kylee looking horrified in the direction of the motel. The old building had shaken loose from its foundation in the sand, and now the slow, continuous tremble of the earth was releasing clouds of dust and chunks of concrete. The building swayed methodically. Bill got to his feet, and Theo and Kylee followed. Bill ran toward the motel.
"We have to get them out of there!" he screamed.
He made it 10 feet when a massive wave slammed over the boardwalk and struck the buildings along the shoreline. The Sea Sun's motel groaned and finally gave in to the elements. Theo felt time slow to a crawl. He saw the motel lean away from the wave and fall, imploding in a cloud of mud and dust. Kylee screamed, and Bill dropped to his knees. Theo grabbed the back of Bill's shirt and, with strength he didn't know he possessed, lifted his friend to his feet and dragged him away from the collapsed building. Bill snapped to his senses, and the three of them ran across Atlantic Avenue to the far side. The wave flooded the street and then sucked backwards toward the ocean. Though some dust rose high into the turbulent sky, most of the debris was stopped by the building behind where the motel had stood, or fell into the retreating wave. Similar dust clouds in the distance disturbed the night sky and told of other collapses and the vast destruction that they had only begun to experience. Theo kept his arms around Kylee as she wept. Bill only stared toward the former motel with a blank expression. Just then, the ground stopped trembling. Theo looked around and saw other people shaking themselves off and taking cautious steps. The grinding motor sound lessened until it appeared that it too had ceased. Though sirens and car alarms still rang out far away, the overall lack of sound was a shock to his ears. As the vice that had been squeezing his head faded away, Theo stepped in front of Bill and Kylee. He had to speak, had to do something to break the silence.
"Guys, I don't know what happened here. I'm not sure anybody knows. I don't know if this is over or just the beginning. We don't know for sure what happened to Mark and Jamie."
Bill opened his mouth to protest, but Theo held up a hand.
"We don't, Bill. But what I do know is that we need to find some place to hide for the night. Someplace safe. Bill, you said Ryan and Michelle are at the building down the street. We know that goddamned wave hit it too, but maybe it's okay. I think we should go there now."
Theo paused and watched, astonished, as Kylee and Bill got up and started to walk in the direction of the tall condominium. He had no experience being a leader, and had never thought anyone would ever follow him. He had felt compelled to say something, but truly hadn't expected the others to jump at his suggestion. The condo building was much larger than the Sea Sun's motel had been before its collapse. It had, as Theo suspected, also fared much better. Theo figured Ryan and Michelle had entered through the parking garage, but the entrance was partially blocked by a large yellow bar with 14-foot maximum height printed in large black type. The bar had fallen off one of its two chains and landed on a car that was stopped in the entrance. The water reached to the top of the car's tires, but the vehicle appeared to be empty.
"Should we move that bar out of the way?" Bill asked as he walked to the entrance.
"No," Theo said, surprising himself again with his quick and decisive reply.
"It's too dark in there, and we don't know what we'd be stumbling into. We need to find another way to get to the stairs."
"Well, this won't work," said Bill as he pulled on the lobby door. Locked.
"I have an idea," Kylee said. "If one of you gentlemen would give me a hand."
She ran toward the boardwalk side of the building, slowing as the pooled water from the monster wave got deeper. Bill and Theo followed. Kylee reached the end of the building where some fortunate condo owners had balconies that looked out over the beach. Not so fortunate anymore, Theo thought.
"Okay, someone needs to help me up here."
Kylee pointed to the second floor balcony. Bill splashed over to her and positioned himself to launch Kylee upwards. She jumped off his hands and grabbed the ledge of the balcony. With impressive strength, she pulled herself to a crouching position. The balcony door was shattered, as were most windows and doors they could see. Kylee disappeared into the darkness of the condo. Theo had enough time to start to think this was a very bad idea. They had no clue who or what was in that apartment. There was a click of a bolt rotating, and Theo turned to see Kylee emerge from the lobby door.
"I know," she said. "I'm awesome."
Theo smiled. He had to agree. 2. Emergency lights had powered on in the stairwell, but several had failed either from the damage to the building, the moisture from the wave, or just lack of maintenance. Either way, there was just enough light to make sure they didn't fall on the slippery concrete. The stairwell seemed endless. Theo lost track of the number of floors as they climbed. Glancing at the building from the outside, he had guessed there were maybe 20, but as exhausted as he was, it seemed like more. He noted that the damage from the wave seemed limited to the first 5 or 6 floors. The stairs above that point were dry, but small cracks along the walls showed that the disaster had impacted the structure throughout. Finally, they arrived at the door to the roof. Theo had a moment to consider what they would do if the exit was locked, or maybe sealed by damage, but then Bill pushed on it and it clicked open. The roof was shockingly free of debris. Theo tried to spot Ryan and Michelle, but could see very little. The stars had been subdued by the debris and smoke in the air.
"Oh, man! I thought you guys were dead!"
Ryan's voice called from the shadows.
"Ryan!"
Bill shouted. "Where the hell are you?"
"Behind you!"
Ryan stepped out from the blackness. Michelle was hiding behind him. Bill made his way over to them. Theo observed that whatever awkward spark had existed between his friend and Michelle earlier tonight had been extinguished by the trauma of what had transpired. He glanced at Kylee and wondered for the first time where they would go from here. Where would any of them go? Ryan eyed them with dawning realization.
"Where's Mark?"
"He and Jamie were in the Sea Suns when it..." Bill's voice trailed off as he turned away from the group.
"Oh no."
Ryan's face fell. Theo stepped forward and took Ryan by the shoulders.
"We don't know anything yet. We aren't even 100% sure they were still in there, and if they were, there's a chance they could be okay. We had to get away from the tidal wave, and we haven't been able to go after them."
Ryan burst into tears.
"Oh, fuck, man. What are we going to do?"
"We'll get in there, Rye," Theo said. "Once the dust has settled, I promise."
Kylee put her arm around Michelle. Bill was sitting on the roof a few feet away. He was lost in his thoughts. Theo released Ryan once he had determined his friend was processing everything in a reasonable way.
"Bill said you came up here to look for a cell signal. Any luck?"
"No, not even close.
I figure either something is blocking the signal within some radius that we can't determine yet, or something took out the nearby towers."
"You think?"
Kylee said, a little smirk crossing her face.
"Maybe it was, I don't know, the earthquake?"
Ryan didn't seem to see the humor. He wiped at his eyes with the back of one hand.
"The earthquake may have been the particular culprit, but I think it and the tidal wave are symptoms of something bigger at work here."
"Okay,"
said Kylee, sitting down in a cross-legged position.
"What do we do?"
Theo saw her deep eyes looking at him hopefully.
"There's not much we can do now but wait for the morning. Ryan, how many people are in this building? Any idea? I'm sure there are a few refugees hanging around, but by and large, most of the people are gone. We saw them streaming out when all the craziness started. And besides, the ones on the first few floors, well..."
He didn't have to continue. For the first time, Theo considered what Kylee might have seen as she passed through the downstairs apartment. He turned to her, and she met his gaze and nodded grimly. Theo wondered how she could be so strong.
"Fair enough," he said.
He walked over to Bill and extended his hand.
"I think the higher we are, the safer, for now at least. Let's go down to the top floor and see if we can find a vacancy."
The group of weary teens made their way down to the highest hallway. Ryan used his iPhone's LED light to illuminate a few feet in front of them. They all tried various doors and found them locked. Theo was about to suggest that they break in when the edge of the small light found a door that stood partially ajar. They cautiously entered the apartment. Moving in a tight pack, they explored each room. Pictures had fallen off the wall and shattered on the marble in the living room. Dishes were scattered and broken all over the kitchen. Mostly, though, the place was in good order, considering the unusual disaster that had befallen it. Theo suggested that the residents of this penthouse suite had bolted and forgot to close the door. It seemed a plausible enough explanation. Ryan claimed a guest room down a marble hallway. He left his phone light on in the center of the living room. To Theo's surprise, Michelle slowly followed Ryan. He turned and saw Bill also watching as Michelle departed. Bill sat dejected on the living room couch and pulled his feet up. Theo felt terrible for Bill. The night's events had hit him hard, but then whatever this was had impacted all of them. It occurred to Theo that he had no way to get in touch with his family. They couldn't know that he was alive and unhurt, and he knew nothing about their safety. Had this thing hit Philadelphia? That thought led itself to another question, one that followed him as he entered the master bedroom with Kylee and curled up in the king-size bed with her in his arms. As Kylee dozed off, Theo stared at the seemingly endless darkness above him. Finally, sleep came to him, and as he drifted away, that one thought kept floating through his mind. If we are in the midst of a huge disaster, where is the media to cover it? Where are the National Guard helicopters? Where is everybody? Chapter 3. 1. Waking once in the middle of the night, Theo had considered the possibility that somehow dawn was never going to arrive. Maybe the sun itself had gone out along with the bright lights of the boardwalk. When he woke the next time, though, sunlight was trickling through the blinds on the bedroom windows. Theo slowly got out of bed, making sure not to disturb Kylee, and entered the bathroom. He wondered where the owners of the condo had spent the night. Were they even still alive? He did his necessary business and pressed the toilet handle. The toilet gave a weak, brief flush. Theo shook his head. He should have realized that the plumbing wasn't likely to work. He turned on the sink and got just enough water out of the pipes to wash his hands before the tap ran out. He walked out to the living room and saw that Bill was already up and gone. Ryan and Michelle's door was closed. Theo left the apartment and found his way back to the stairwell. When he emerged on the roof, the sunlight temporarily blinded him. He blinked until his vision cleared. Bill was sitting on the edge of the building with his legs hanging in the air 200 or so feet above the street. Theo walked intentionally loud to signal his approach.
"There's no way they survived," Bill spoke without turning.
"You don't know that," Theo said. He looked out over the edge. The beach was wet, but the ocean seemed to be behaving normally. The boardwalk was damaged in some places, but overall not too bad. The buildings along the boardwalk were a mixed bag. Some, especially the taller condos, were structurally intact, at least to the naked eye. Many of the smaller structures had suffered tremendous damage or had been wiped out completely. The dust clouds had settled to a height of maybe 20 feet, making it difficult for Theo to see the streets in any great detail.
"What I know," said Bill, "is that Mark was in that building and the fucking thing is just rubble and dust."
"And what if you're right? That doesn't change the fact that we need to get home and find out what the hell happened. There's some reason that nobody is down there digging through the debris. Maybe they somehow just don't know. That means if we want to save Mark and anyone else who may be trapped or hurt, we need to get out of here and get them some help." Bill sighed. He looked exhausted. Theo wondered if his friend had slept at all.
"I guess you're right, man. I'm just scared. I don't understand any of this."
He swung his legs back onto the roof and stood up. Theo nodded his agreement. Who could possibly understand what had happened? What was still happening? When Theo and Bill got back to the apartment, the others were all up. Michelle was clinging to Ryan. Theo locked eyes with Kylee and she ran over to him.
"Have you guys figured out what our next move should be?" she asked.
"Theo thinks our best hope at saving ourselves and, you know, is to get out of this damned town and get help." Bill spoke from the foyer and he kept eyeing the door. He was ready to face whatever came next. 2. The five teens descended the dark stairwell and emerged into the hazy daylight below. Ribbons of dust floated in the current of sea air. The street and sidewalk, built as they were on tightly packed sand, had warped and cracked from the earthquake. Theo led his friends carefully back onto Atlantic Avenue. They stopped and surveyed the destruction. Bodies lined the streets. Michelle turned toward Ryan and began to cry, but Theo was impressed to see Kylee carefully compose herself and remain calm.
"I thought you said there were people all over the street," Ryan said. "I don't see anybody."
He gulped.
"Not anybody alive, anyway."
Theo shrugged.
"My guess is many of them got themselves to shelter just like we did. But now maybe most of them are on their way home."
After some debate, they agreed to cut straight back toward the bay side of the island. That way they could get some idea of what was happening on the far end of the wetlands while they walked to the bridge. They passed by a convenience store. Although the store had survived the earthquake and been nowhere near the tidal wave, the glass door and windows were broken. Dirty people, some of them clearly wounded, streamed in and out of the store like ants. Bill ran across the parking lot and looked in.
"People are seriously stealing from a store in the middle of all this?"
He turned and grabbed a scrawny young man with a series of complex tattoos down the length of both arms.
"What the fuck is wrong with you people?"
The man shoved Bill away from him, dropping several bottles of iced tea, which shattered on the ground, and screamed incoherently as he stumbled off around the corner.
"Let him go," Theo said. "He's drunk off his ass."
Bill nodded.
"Okay, okay. This just seems so wrong."
Theo had seen plenty of news footage of looting during chaos. This break-in didn't surprise him at all.
"People do crazy stuff. It's just one more reason to get out of here. Let's keep moving."
They left the raided store behind them and crossed Ventnor Avenue. One more side street would lead to the wetlands. Theo looked at his friends. They all had similar looks of grim resolve. He promised himself that he would see them all to safety and then do whatever he could to get help for Mark and Jamie. Still, there was no police presence. The town had devolved into absolute chaos. He heard screams all around and couldn't tell whether they were screams of pain, frustration, or fear. Maybe all of the above. The teens came out of the small street and onto Winchester Avenue. Theo walked in the lead. He scanned the horizon, expecting to see smoke rising in the distance. Surely the damage extended beyond the narrow strip of island. He was shocked that the bright light of the clear morning sky was unimpeded by any smoke. He squinted his eyes and looked again. The sky was bright blue. Below that, Theo's jaw dropped. Ryan walked up next to him.
"What's wrong?"
He looked up, and the widening of his eyes conveyed that he saw exactly what was wrong. Not only was there no smoke rising from the houses and shopping centers across the wetlands, there were no houses, no centers, and no wetlands. The ocean waters lapped against the side of the raised street, and the waves pushed onto the road, leaving wet foam. Book 2, The Island. Chapter 4. 1.
"I don't understand. Where is everything?"
Ryan backed away slowly from the sight of the ocean, where the inner part of the town should have been. Michelle ran up to him, and they embraced, frightened. Bill and Kylee approached Theo. It seemed to him that they wanted him to provide some kind of reassurance. He had promised to save his friends, but what could have prepared him for this?
"I don't think we should give up on checking out the bridge," Theo said. "What good would that do?" Ryan asked.
Theo knew it probably wouldn't do any good at all, but he wanted to get them moving again in pursuit of a goal both physically and mentally.
Let's just see what's going on down there. It will give us a better sense of how bad the destruction really is.
Destruction doesn't seem a strong enough word for this, Michelle said.
They all turned to her, surprised to hear her voice.
This is absolute devastation. There's nothing left.
At that, they proceeded in silence, each processing his or her own thoughts about the impossible situation. As Theo expected, the bridge was gone. The twisted remnants of the steel beams jutted out of the ground like crooked teeth. Beyond that, nothing.
This isn't right, Kylee said.
No kidding, this isn't right,
Michelle exclaimed.
No, that's not what I mean.
Kylee crouched by the edge of the ground, where the asphalt broke off and the metal beams ended.
The street was demolished right where the bridge passed the edge of the land, right? Well, where is the rest of the bridge? What about cars that were traveling across?
She's right, Theo said. It's not just that there's too much water here. There's nothing floating in it that should be there. Bill darted forward. Before Theo could stop him, he jumped off the edge and into the ocean. With no time to think, Theo jumped in after him. As he splashed into the warm water, it occurred to him that his keys and wallet were in his pockets. Well, nothing to be done about that now. Bill was swimming ahead. There was no chance of catching him, especially with a few seconds' head start. Fortunately, Bill came to a stop. He dropped below the surface of the water and was gone for a few frightening seconds before he emerged facing Theo.
The ground drops out,
Bill shouted back. His eyes were wide.
It was barely more than waist height for a while, and now I can't even feel the bottom. We are way out in the ocean, man. This is the real thing. Okay, just do me a favor and come back. We'll figure this out.
Bill threw his hands in the air as if to say, how exactly will we do that? But he started paddling back to land. 2. The teens wandered back toward the center of town. By now, other survivors were emerging from the buildings. They were heading in different directions, but Theo felt sure that eventually they would all discover what he and his friends had seen for themselves. The panic gripping the survivors was only going to increase. Michelle pointed out that they hadn't had anything to eat in a long time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.